Ladies and gentlemen, what is going on and welcome to another video. My name is Nathaniel Morton and I am a sports performance coach who specializes in basketball players. So if you are a basketball player who wants to improve your performance and take your game to the next level, then you, my friend, are in the right place and you should subscribe to this channel. Also, comment jump down below, J-U-M-P in the comment section, if you want a free vertical jump training program and if you want me to personally coach you, I will be your coach. Think about if of everybody on your team, you had me to coach you, who is going to eventually become the best player on the team? You are. So that will be linked down below in the pinned comment and the description of this video, but let's get into it. In this video, I'm going to give you three exercises that you can do to improve your reactive strength. Now, what is reactive strength and why do we as basketball players need good reactive strength? Reactive strength is your body's ability to react quickly to any given stretch. So we're talking about the stretch shortening cycle. And for basketball players, we're mainly talking about the lower body. We are going to use plyometrics as a main source to improve our reactive strength. So it's your body's ability, the ability of your neuromuscular system, your nervous system plus your muscles to react rapidly to any given stretch or ground contact. So think about when you're sprinting, think about when you're jumping, think about when you're cutting, think about when you're trying to beat your man off the dribble. I get that question all the time. Nate, I need a quicker first step. There's a lot of factors that go into it, but you need to improve your reactive strength. So that is why we need it as basketball players. And these are the three exercises that are going to help you improve your reactive strength. Number one is sprinting. Ladies and gentlemen, this blows my mind. How? I'm in a men's league, okay? I'm not going to the NBA at this point. At this point, I'm devoting most of my life to coaching younger athletes so that they can potentially go to college and the NBA. I myself am not gonna make it to the NBA, okay? I've had my time, I'm past my prime. But it blows my mind when I play in my men's league and I see people who I see in the gym training like a bodybuilder and they're training for hypertrophy and then they're playing in the men's league and they get hurt and they wonder why they get hurt. And I'm looking at their training, I'm like, bro, you don't ever do any sprinting. You don't ever do any jumping, but you're the first person to get on the bench press every single Monday. So if you don't sprint at least one time per week, okay, 2 to 3 times per week is better. If you don't sprint at least one time per week, then you are not going to improve your performance and your reactive strength as much as possible. It seems simple. It's just sprinting. Everybody sprints. You sprint in basketball. So if you do sprint in basketball multiple times a week, that can count. But I'm more so talking about doing sprints as an exercise, not an activity. As an exercise, you set out to go from point A to point B as fast as possible. Because when we play basketball, of course we sprint, but we don't get much top end speed. We sprint to catch up with the offensive man and then we cut and we're pivoting and we're playing defense. I'm talking about sprinting from here to there, 30 to 40 yards as fast as you possibly can. Gotta be doing that 1 to 2 times per week because listen, if reactive strength is It has to do with a rapid stretch in ground contact times. Think about when you're sprinting. How many ground contacts do you get when you're sprinting? Every single step is a ground contact. Every single step is the stretch shortening cycle in motion. Every single step, you are improving and increasing your reactive strength. So you need to be doing sprints. Now, the next exercise, exercise number two, sprinting is lower in load. Sprinting is high intensity, but it is lower in load than something like exercise number two, which is a depth jump or a drop jump. So over here with sprints, we have multiple very fast ground contact times. When we move over to something like depth jumps, we are only contacting the ground one time when we drop off the box, but it is more force and we are absorbing more force and then producing more force, still working on reactive strength, but you need both of these, both types of exercises to be included in your programming to get the best performance that you possibly can. For depth jumps or drop jumps, and the difference between depth jumps and drop jumps is that for depth jumps, you are focusing on getting as high as possible. For drop jumps, you're focusing on getting off of the ground as fast as possible. So for depth jumps, since you're trying to jump as high as possible, you're going to load a little bit more. There's going to be a little bit more knee bend and a longer ground contact time. And for drop jumps, you're not going to jump as high, but you're going to get quicker. You're going to react quicker off of the ground. So when it comes to reactive strength, both of these are good, but drop jumps are a little bit better, focusing on getting off the ground as fast as possible. But for depth jumps and drop jumps, the main thing that I want you to keep in mind is that there's a such thing as structural integrity. So you need to go from a 6-inch box to a 12-inch box to an 18-inch box to a 24-inch box, and you do not move to the next box until you can successfully do the lower box. If you go too high on a box, if you use a tall box too quickly, your body's not going to focus on building reactive strength. It's going to focus on bracing for impact. So if you can't successfully brace for impact on a lower box, then going even higher, your body's never going to improve in reactive strength. So make sure you go from a low box first, do that, rep it out, make sure you do that for a couple weeks, then increase the box once the structural integrity, your muscle, your neuromuscular system, your tendons, your ligaments, everything can work together as a whole to propel you up onto the next box. So that's exercise number two. Number one, we got sprinting. Number two, we got depth jumps or drop jumps. And number three, which is the most advanced of all of them, and I wouldn't do these until you can successfully do drop jumps off of a high box, are hurdle jumps. Okay, hurdle jumps is just a depth jump on steroids. Okay, so if you can't do depth jumps, then don't do repeated hurdle jumps, jumping over hurdles repeatedly. So this is why whenever I did my review of the Lost Breeds program, day one, they had hurdle jumps. That's not good. People who just get into the Lost Breeds program and they start doing hurdle jumps on day one, they don't have the structural integrity to go ahead and do hurdle jumps. They're going to get hurt, they're going to get knee pain, or their body's just gonna be focused on bracing instead of increasing reactive speed, reactive strength. So the Lost Breed had all good intentions when they were writing that, but you need to work your way up to hurdle jumps. You can't just jump in it straight away. For hurdle jumps, like I said, you want to first be able to do drop jumps successfully off of a high box. Then a regression of repeated hurdle jumps would be to do a baby jump in between. So a big jump, baby jump, big jump, baby jump. And then progress your way up to repeated big jumps over high hurdles. But these are three exercises that you could do to improve your reactive strength and jump higher, run faster, beat your man off the dribble. And let me give you the sets and reps really quickly. So for sprints, it'd be good to do anywhere from 3 to 8 sets of sprints, 30 to 40 yards. Make sure you warm up to it with some submaximal sprints, but then 3 to 8 sets of 30 to 40 yards as fast as you possibly can. I would do that 1 to 3 times per week, depending on how often you play basketball. If you're in season, only do it once a week. If you're off season, you could do it 2 to 3 times per week. For depth jumps and for drop jumps, I would do 4 sets of 5 reps. I never do more than that. Now I work my way up to my 4 working sets of 5 reps. So I might do 5 reps on a 6-inch box, then a 12-inch box, then an 18-inch box, then a 24-inch box. Then I do my 4 sets of 5 reps on a 30-inch box. So that's what you should do. Make sure you start low and progress your way up. And then for hurdle jumps, I do something like 4 sets of 3 jumps. These are high intensity, so you don't need that high of volume. Okay. And I would do depth jumps or drop jumps twice a week and hurdle jumps 1 to 2 times per week. So guys, there you have it. These are 3 exercises that you can do to improve your reactive strength as a basketball player. Comment jump down below if you want a free vertical jump program, or link down below will be in the description and in the pinned comment if you want me to personally be your coach. Peace.
Young beast mode from the East Coast. A young kid with a West Coast feel. And I don't even know how the West Coast feel. I'm from where it's cold. The city made of steel, where a lot of fold, only couple keep it real right. Back seal, keep it real tight. Keep 2 L's just like Cool J. My heart's cold as ice cube. Praying it's a good day. I'm at a crossroads, but in a good way. I got money on my line.